It's the stuff of nightmares on a main road in broad daylight. A man and his car vanish without trace.
Until I see Gareth, alive or dead, in my eyes he's still living.
Has he joined the ranks of Northern Ireland's disappeared?
Somebody out there does know something.
And the case is shrouded in a silence born of fear.
People may pray in the silence of their own houses for the O'Connor family and for similar disappeared victims. They are not going to make a public noise about it. It's too dangerous.
Almost 6 weeks ago, Gareth O'Connor left his home here in Armagh to make the short trip to Dundalk. He vanished en route and hasn't been seen since, despite major police inquiries on both sides of the border. The story behind his disappearance offers us a glimpse into a world of greed, intimidation, fraud, and probably even murder. It also raises serious questions about the state of republicanism 6 years after the second IRA ceasefire. Gareth O'Connor captured on camera at a family celebration. It was a happy occasion, but now his family fear that they are to be left with nothing but videotape and memories.
Gareth was 24-year-old, father of two. He's a welder by trade, and in his spare time he fixed up cars and sold them on for a couple of pounds. He's very much a family man. He has two children and spent a lot of time with them. And he was very good to me and my wife both, and has been all his life. He's a very friendly, kind person.
He was an excellent family man. Gareth was very, very witty. He was a big agent, to be quite honest with you. But he was a very caring person. His top priorities was Leona and his children. They came first at all times.
Gareth was a big, he's been a bodybuilder for 15 years. He was a big, big fella now. He's been at the weights, he'd been 5'11" and very, very, very well built. 50-odd chest, very well built.
Elsewhere in the city, however, there were those with a different view of O'Connor. He was known to throw his weight around and had convictions for assault. A fearsome reputation was fuelled by the fact that he was facing terrorist charges. He was on bail and had to report twice a day to Dundalk.
He would have had a pattern for a Sunday. Sunday morning would have been, he would have left very early Sunday morning so he'd get back early to spend time with the two boys.
But Gareth O'Connor was troubled by a financial matter. He and many others in Armagh had lost out in an underground business venture. It was run by a man in his 20s who promised amazing returns on cash in hand. Anyone who bothered to ask was told he was making a killing by supplying smuggled computers to the government. At first, relatively small sums changed hands, but as word spread and the first profits came through, people flocked to invest, including Gareth O'Connor. Some saw the scheme as a way of laundering their own dirty money.
What kinds of sums of money were involved?
There was anything from £1,000 to £100,000 involved here.
So people actually invested £100,000?
There was people that invested £100,000, yes.
In fact, it was a scam, nothing more than a classic pyramid scheme. The link man was merely using incoming cash to pay those further up the chain. It was always doomed to collapse, and last September that's exactly what happened. Hardest hit were the last ones to put money in, and they were often the ones who were putting in the most.
And did they lose that money?
They have lost that money, yes.
Was it all cash?
It had to be all cash. That was a stipulation that you got into it. It had to be all cash.
Insight understands that the police have received a handful of complaints about the pyramid scheme relating to a six-figure sum. They've now prepared a file for the Director of Public Prosecutions. But they believe that what they know may just be the tip of the iceberg. They think that there are other people out there who aren't coming forward because they don't want to answer questions about where their money came from in the first place. They weren't going to wait for the law to take its course. In September last year, some of them, including O'Connor, confronted the scheme's mastermind at a business in Keady. Local people say he was taken to a house where he wrote a statement which O'Connor kept. Police are aware of an incident, but have no complaint. Insight has obtained a copy of the handwritten note, which is also in the possession of detectives. In it, the scam's boss describes his movements in the days after the collapse of his scheme. He and his family are moved from house to house by two men, one of them a leading Republican. Under virtual house arrest, The scamster is asked about the finances on his cars and a holiday home abroad, and he claims at one point to have handed over £400,000 to the Republican.
Can I ask you who that was?
The person was the OC of North Armagh, the Provisional IRA. He's a well-known member around Armagh. Everyone knows who he is.
There's no paper trail for the police to follow, and amid bitter recrimination, many believe the Provisionals were the only ones to benefit from the scheme, although Republicans deny this.
His family have made reference to some form of investment scheme, a pyramid scheme that was on the go in the Armagh area leading up to his disappearance. Have you heard anything of that?
No, I mean, I've heard over the years periodically about these pyramid schemes going in many areas right across the north. I'm not sure if they're in the south as well. I didn't have any specific knowledge of anyone in the Armagh City area at all.
To an organisation which has always been deeply sensitive to allegations of criminality, the claims of Republican involvement in such a scam are deeply embarrassing. But there's always been an uneasy relationship between politics and profit in Republicanism. The IRA needed a flow of cash to fight its armed campaign. Much of its income came from illegal sources, and although the war machine is now idling, it appears that the money-making is still in top gear. Jewellery-laden loyalists and designer clothes have become the focus of public outrage over organised crime. But only last week a conference was told that as many mafia-style gangs have links to Republicans as loyalists. And last year MPs were told that the IRA's yearly income is between £5 and £8 million. That's more than the UVF and UDA combined.
Traditionally, Republican activity has largely centred on the revenue type offences, fuel smuggling, alcohol, tobacco smuggling. The Loyalists have done some of those things, but they've always also been much more prominent at the, if you like, the heavy end of crime, extortion, armed robbery, things like that.
It's not a subject on which the PSNI likes to elaborate.
How deeply involved in organised crime are the IRA in particular?
Well, I don't want to discuss individual organisations. I've tried to keep the remarks as general as possible, so as to give people a general idea of what's going on. But as you know, the Provisional IRA has to raise certain funds for its activities, and not all of those funds are raised by raffles and ballots.
That fundraising is still going on in spite of the ceasefire?
Well, an organisation needs funds to keep going, and there are different ways of doing it, yes.
Well, I'd like to see what statistics and what evidence they have to back that up. I mean, they quite often make these allegations about Republicans, and then when you narrow it down, you find that it is not people in the IRA or even people connected with Sinn Féin that they're talking about. So I'd like to see some detail of these figures. I mean, you know, these are advanced quite often, I think, to smokescreen their own inactivity. I can see quite a lot of illegal activity going on all of the time. The police and the customs appear to be turning quite a blind eye to some of it.
Petrol smuggling and diesel laundering are at rampant proportions. Two-thirds of all oil retail outlets now peddle at least some illegal fuel. It costs the Exchequer hundreds of millions of pounds, and there are massive amounts of money to be made.
One of the big problems is that people do tend to perceive these offences, particularly excise offences, as victimless crime. You know, if you're buying cheap diesel, well, sure, nobody loses. Well, you eventually lose when your car engine seizes up. You lose when there's not enough money to fund nurses and hospitals. So these crimes aren't victimless.
Experts say that the IRA's rackets are carefully chosen to avoid undermining its own standing in the nationalist community and ultimately harming Sinn Féin's electoral position. Any suggestion that they've dirtied their hands on a scam which robbed many of that community could be extremely damaging.
For a long time, what happened was that the struggle against the British state, the struggle against the UK, was one which needed funds to support it. You needed to have money, and what various ways of getting that included robberies, included protection rackets and so on. And clearly that kind of material, that kind of activity looked very much like ordinary gangsterism to many people. But it had a political goal, it had a political struggle which it was supporting. Now that that military campaign is less prominent, is less important, the role of that kind of activity will over time, I think, in time will diminish. The question is how quickly that will happen and how much of the Republican movement will be left involved in that kind of residual gangster-like activity, some of which is clearly happening at the moment.
In the months after the collapse of the pyramid scheme, this leaflet started circulating in border areas. It listed a number of Republicans, including the alleged IRA OC in North Armagh, and mounted vicious personal attacks, as well as accusing them of ripping off the nationalist community. O'Connor was widely blamed for being the author.
Gareth was the man who was asking all the questions. People come to that lost money had come to Gareth and asked him to help them. And Gareth, being the helpful person that he was, went and asked this person for his money and other people's money back.
And that's how you would say he probably came to their attention?
That's how he came to their attention, and I think that that is why he got the threat from the Provisional IRA, that he was asking too many questions and he was standing too many clothes and he was getting too close.
But he didn't stop there. He began visiting the Republicans he blamed for spiriting away the cash. There are reports he threatened them, and in some cases their families. He was now posing a direct and very public challenge to the authority and standing of the Republican movement.
The ceasefire really meant ceasefire. We won't kill British soldiers or UC men. We won't bomb in England, won't bomb in Ireland. But they proceeded, both the Loyalists and the IRA, proceeded to control their own people, if you want to call them that, the Catholic people on one side and the Protestant people on the other.
On the morning of Sunday, May the 11th, Gareth O'Connor said goodbye to his family and headed off as normal along a route to Dundalk Garda Station that would have been second nature to him. His partner Leona texted him and he replied. It was to be their last contact. At 8.56 in the morning, a security camera picked him up passing through Newton Hamilton in South Armagh. That was the last sighting of him.
I knew straight away from about 12 o'clock. I knew once Gareth hadn't returned for Caelan, then I knew that something was seriously wrong, and then I phoned Leona, his girlfriend, and she says his phones have been switched off. She'd been trying to ring him constantly. And I just knew from that time, once he wasn't back. So then we tried to contact his friend, and he was at the Armagh match, and we couldn't get in contact with him. So then once we phoned the garage station and he hadn't turned up, that's when I knew something had been wrong.
The O'Connors' instincts about their son were correct, but initially their fears centred on an ominous development earlier in the week, which still placed the provisionals in the frame.
The police came to Gareth's house on the Thursday at 5:40 and gave Gareth the threat that it was wrote out on a bit of paper to say that the Provisional IRA, that the police, the PSNI, had information that the Provisional IRA were looking to interview Gareth about distant Republican activities. So it was the first thing that came into my head, that the fact that he was going through South Armagh, and that was a big Provisional IRA territory, and that was my fear, that the Provisional IRA have him.
O'Connor was one of four men arrested in County Monaghan in November last year. Before they were freed on bail, a court heard they were members of a real IRA active service unit. The O'Connors reject any suggestion that their son was active in dissident Republican ranks.
His trial's in January 2004. Mm-hmm. And the only charges they have on him is membership, which doesn't really hold. They have no evidence. He's not a member, or never has been.
And was he confident that he was going to be acquitted?
He was confident that he was welcome, that he had no reason to fear anything. It was just an inconvenience that he had to go and say no for twice a day. That's the only inconvenience.
Insight has learned that O'Connor did in fact have links with the real IRA. He would have been something of a catch, literally lending muscle to a faction always in the shadow of the provisionals. At first he was embraced with open arms, but as time went on, things began to change.
The real IRA has been trying to distance itself from O'Connor since he disappeared. A source close to that group's leadership told us that he was under investigation amid suspicions that he had been cooperating with authorities on both sides of the border. They said that the net was closing in on him when he vanished, but that the provisionals got there first. Either way, it's clear they're not contemplating any form of reprisal.
The bomb contained around 1,200 pounds of explosives packed into two large barrels. Police commanders say if it had detonated, it would have caused devastation on a massive scale.
Two more successes against the dissidents at the weekend show that information is still seeping from the real IRA. And of course, O'Connor is unable to respond to the claims now being made against him.
Did you as a mother sense that there was anything playing in Gareth's mind? Was there any reason why he would voluntarily disappear?
No, that didn't even come into my head. He's just not that type of a person. He would not put any of us through this. He thought too much of Leona and thought too much of his children to do that. He'd everything going for him. Like, they've just bought their house. I mean, there was no shortage of money, but money wasn't a problem. He would have no reason whatsoever. I mean, his case wasn't to January next year. So, like, he had from now to then to come and go. Why would he get up and just run? He's no passport. He can't leave the country.
Every inch of his route has been examined by police, but there was no trace of a crash or a struggle, nor has his car been recovered. Three people have been arrested, including the alleged IRA man named in the statement, but all were freed without charge. Police sources say their inquiries have taken them into the murky underworld of Republican terrorism, smuggling and racketeering. Following an appeal by the Catholic primate, the IRA denied involvement.
I do not believe them. They've lied all their lives. They've lied in the past. They've lied about the disappeared. Why should I believe them? It would take at least five men to hold Gareth, unless they've used a stun gun or something. It would take at least five men to hold him.
And then you also have to have a support apparatus there to get rid of a car.
That's right, say... yes. There would have to be, in my opinion, there would have to be at least eight men involved in this operation.
And you would say that the only group around here with that kind of apparatus would be the IRA?
They are the only group that can do it. They're well practiced at it, especially in South Armagh, where people know not to talk, or this will happen to them as well.
Well, the IRA issued a statement saying they were not involved at all in the disappearance of Mr. O'Connor. And I accept that. From my discussion with any Republicans on the ground in South Armagh, no one is aware of what happened to Mr. O'Connor.
If it is an IRA job, then because of the political situation, the IRA cannot admit it, and they cannot allow any evidence to be produced that would tie them up. Therefore, the body disappears. It's because of the politics. If the IRA or their associates were found to have committed a murder, it would upset the political situation and the possibility of the restoration of the Assembly and things like that.
If Gareth O'Connor was abducted to send a message to the community, it appears to have worked. Police are struggling to get information, and few will speak publicly about the case. Even those who lost sizeable sums in the pyramid scheme were too afraid to take part in this programme.
The omerta, the silence, must never be broken. So you're not allowed to speak up and criticise them. And therefore most people say, well, I have a wife, I have a family, I have a small business, I've got a car, I've got a tractor. I don't want these things burned, I don't want them destroyed. I get on with my own life. I don't blame the people for not speaking out. But this culture will have to be dissipated in some way or other.
I think what they're trying to do is quieten the community. We've got the boy that come asking all the questions. The next one comes asking all the questions is going to go too. That's my opinion is what they're doing.
There are those who want to silence the O'Connors as well. Last week a hammer was thrown through the window of their home. They're also frustrated at the lack of political support. Their ordeal is all too familiar to Margaret McKinney, whose son Brian was murdered by the IRA in 1978. His body was only recovered from a bog in County Monaghan 21 years on.
At that particular time, there was nobody, there was a lot of fear going about, you know. We're talking about it and nobody wanted to know. And we were left all them years without anyone knowing, and it was until the 1994 when the first ceasefire came that I got the opportunity to speak out and tell my story. And some of my neighbours came and apologised, for they were told that I had been in contact with Brian all over the years. About the middle of May 99, the digs started in a place called Colga in Monaghan. And then it was 6 weeks later, on the 29th of June 99, his body was found. The Garda took it on themselves to go to this part that they wanted to do at the beginning, but the powers of beast said, no, that's not the information to men. So they went, and the first couple of shovelfuls, there was brand shoes. Three white trainers, with stripes up beside them. And they had the bodies, there was two bodies in the grave, young John McClure, and they were covered over with howie rocks. They were never meant to be found.
News of Gareth O'Connor's disappearance reopened wounds that had barely healed.
Just relived it all again, and I knew what Mrs. O'Connor and her husband and family were going through. Just wished I had been with them, you know, to see if I could comfort them. Not that you could comfort anybody, you know, in that situation, but it's, you know, I don't think there's any call for to do that if they have shot that fella, if he's dead. Oh, just leave his body out somewhere to be found. It doesn't help much, you know, to know that he's gone, but at least they'll know where he is.
I would like, if enough prominent people, Amnesty International, the Irish Americans, and so on, people who have influence with the IRA, they should all speak out and have this body restored. I think that's the absolutely essential point of this case. Because we do not want a culture of this. I've dealt with all the disappeared people in the last 30 years. There are still 10 disappeared. Mr. O'Connor makes number 11.
Of course it's worrying, but that presumes that someone has taken him, or he has disappeared against his will. And we don't know any of this. And people disappear all of the time. If it is against their will, if people have been kidnapped or taken away by someone, that is worrying. But we don't know the circumstances of Mr. O'Connor's disappearance. I haven't heard anyone advance any firm theory as to what has happened to him or where he has gone.
The O'Connors have a very firm theory and believe that the community cannot afford to ignore what has happened to their son.
Whatever they wanted to do, they've done it. Why have they not let him go? My head's telling me he's not alive, but in my heart there is a bit of hoping. Just hoping I'm wrong, but I don't think I am.
Who is next? Whose son is going to be the next that steps out of line with the Provisional IRA member and they take him away? And God knows if he'll come back, if he's dead or alive. No one knows.